Hi there, my name is Jeremy Thomas, and I am the host of Shed Talks. Shed Talks hopes to be an entertaining, informative podcast that looks at well-being and mental health. It's all going to be great. Enjoy. And welcome to Shed Talks. Our very special guest today has had an extraordinary life. A graduate of the LSE, he is the father of four daughters. He cites his main hobbies as carbohydrates, sleep, and complaining, but not necessarily in that order. He's written 9 books, including the Whitbread Prize-winning first novel, White City Blue, and the highly regarded Rumours of a Hurricane and When We Were Rich. However, it is for his outstanding memoir, The Scent of Dried Roses, that he will probably be best remembered, a book most likely to be devoured by listeners of Shed Talks. Beyond this, he's written publicly and extensively about his own mental health through columns and interviews in The Guardian and The Times. However, in 2019, he decided to pull up the stumps, stop discussing the subject, and set up a boot camp on Substack for writers instead. Welcome, Tim Lott.
Thank you.
Great to have you here, Tim. And I think when we first met on the telephone, I said how knocked out I was with The Scent of Dried Roses, and I still am knocked out with it. And I just, in a way, it would be very easy to sort of metaphorically photocopy that book. But hopefully we can talk about you and that in the Shed Talk today. So just to kick it off, before anything else, was it easier to have 4 daughters than to write 4 novels?
That's somewhat comparing apples with oranges, but I would certainly say that both of them, or neither of them, are easy.
I mean, did you take to parenting like a duck to water?
No.
No.
No. I wouldn't. I don't think any of my children would describe me as the greatest father in the world.
Right.
You know, certainly my ex-wives wouldn't. Not that I think I'm a bad father, but I sometimes see fathers and think, yeah, I'm not like that. I'm sort of very distracted and distractible.
Yes.
So we're talking about mental health, so I do suffer ADHD, and though I'm not sure suffer is the right word, probably is the right word, but, you know, it's not the ideal qualification for parenting.
Yeah.
When you can't bring your attention to bear for very long, or you get overwhelmed very, very easily by too much chaos or confusion, I sort of tend to freeze. So it's the opposite of really the sort of calm, resilient parent. It's more like a man who panics or closes down in the face of chaos.
Yes.
You know, I have very good relationships with all my daughters, and I'm incredibly loving of them, and I think they're very loving towards me. But I'm not sort of, I don't think of myself as a textbook. I don't think I'll be writing a book on parenting anytime soon.
Okay, well, you know, I'm sure you're a top dad in many ways, but perhaps not in a conventional way. Anyway, let's talk about you, though. You were brought up in Southall, West London. Mum and Dad, Jean and Jack, who are pretty fantastic. One elder brother and one still to come. It's right to say that when you were born, there were various problems which involved you having to be in hospital for the first 3 months of your life.
That's right, though I didn't realise that until I was researching The Scent of Dried Roses. There were a lot of things I didn't find out until I started to research that book.
Gosh.
Among them, you know, I mean, all I was ever told was that I had something wrong with my kidney.
Right.
And that my kidney had to be removed. I certainly didn't know that I spent 3 months in hospital. I certainly didn't know that my mother spent 3 months in hospital with me and didn't see my other brother during that 3 months. Might explain why he was quite resentful towards me for a large part of my childhood. I certainly didn't know that I was born with cancer until I was 27, 28, I think I learned that. A doctor mentioned it to me, that I had something called Wilms' tumour. It's a rare childhood tumour and has to be removed quickly.
Right.
I also learned quite recently, though I'd heard this as a rumour, that babies at that time were commonly operated on without an anaesthetic, which I think is quite some... I think it's enough to have quite a... You know, I've got quite a wide array of difficult early life experiences, put it that way.
Yes, yes. And even if they were stored in a, you know...
Absolutely, no, but they're in there somewhere.
Yeah. No, I get it. Gosh. So anyway, you came home and off you go. And your parents were very loving, from what I can understand.
I don't actually know that. I mean, my father was loving in the way that fathers at that time were loving, quite stern, though, and quite distant. I didn't see that much of him. My mother, I just can't remember. I mean, I'm assuming she was loving because everyone tells me she was.
Yes.
But I don't know. That remains a mystery to me.
Yes. I liked the way you drew them in the book. I thought that was... really successful for me. It was just I got them immediately, particularly your father, who was, you know, as I would say, that quintessentially English person, very decent guy. But
was.
You know, and I hope you don't mind me talking about this, but you know what I think is an extraordinary thing is your mum had this illness or condition or whatever, you know, alopecia. And I think that's quite a big thing. And I don't know whether you were aware of it when you were growing up.
Oh, I was absolutely aware of this. I mean, I could not be aware of it since my mother wore wigs
right.
all through my childhood. But, you know, I certainly didn't really give much thought in the way that children don't to how much suffering that might have caused my mother. And I'm sure it was considerable at that time when women's hair, you know, was, it's not like today when you can shave your hair off and get away with it. But even though I was quite shocked by that, that Oscars.
Oh, yes. Will Smith and everything. Yeah.
Yeah. When his wife has alopecia and has lost her hair. And, you know, Dave Chappelle seemed to have considered... It was Dave Chappelle, wasn't it?
Chris Rock, sorry.
Thought it was okay to laugh at her for it. And that sort of struck home with me, actually.
Yes, oh, I'm sure.
Because I thought, you know, it's a really hard thing to live with. And certainly it was hard for my mother.
Well, I imagine, and I'm asking the question because it seemed to me such a big thing. And yet sometimes in families... You know, people going to... I mean, I know someone who's only got one arm, a woman who's only got one arm, she's got three kids. And I said it once to her father, his friend of mine, and they said it's never discussed. They don't even talk about it. They never even think about it. It's just...
Mm.
And I don't think, you know, I think that's not true, actually, because I think what children are like is when, you know, it's what other people think that can count. So I just wondered about you, whether you were, you know, felt very protective towards her, whether you were embarrassed about it or what.
Neither. I mean, I wasn't embarrassed about it because, you know, my mother was never to be seen without her wigs.
Yeah.
You know, protective. I was just, you know, a standard child and it was my job to be protected. I don't think I was protective towards her,
right?
Because I didn't see the problem, you know, in a way, and which is a good thing in some ways.
Yeah, I mean, I wasn't
conscious of it being a big issue, though I think it really was. And my father, interestingly, said that he never saw my mother without her hair, never in his life.
My goodness,
which is extraordinary.
It is, isn't it? I mean, unbelievable, but not extraordinary considering those times.
No, I mean, their sort of image of femaleness was at the centre of that relationship, as it was for all marriages at the time, I suppose.
And yes.
My mother would have been terrified to damage that image, I suppose, of a woman, of which hair was an integral part.
Yeah. And she was a tennis player, wasn't she?
Yes, ferociously competitive. Unfortunately, also endlessly unsuccessful. She always sort of, you know, lost when she played in tournaments.
Right.
I remember a very clear memory of her finally getting to the final of the local tennis club tournament and losing at the last minute.
Oh, yes.
And
yes.
I've never seen her so distressed. We always had a motto in our family that we were always runners-up and never winners. And, that was kind of how we saw ourselves.
Oh, right. Okay. Well, you know, I just think, I suppose you look at that now, don't you, and how you would feel now, and I would be terrified that this wig would blow off or something would happen.
Must have been so anxiety making. I can't imagine.
Yeah, incredible. Anyway, moving on. So you zoomed through your early years, but you went in the end to school, and you were quite bookish, weren't you, at school?
Yeah, I spent a lot of the time in the library, not the school library, the local library,
right,
Jubilee Gardens Library, reading everything I could get my hands on. One of the benefits of the extreme boredom that existed in those days in the 1960s and 70s, I don't think my children have got the remotest idea about what it feels like to be that bored.
Yes.
It's like having a sort of massive, heavy, wet blanket on you. And it was a very boring time. I mean, I'm constantly astonished now about how things change at such an incredible pace. I mean, the late 70s and early 70s, things were like stuck in place. They felt very rigid, very safe, but unbelievably boring.
But everything was moving very slowly. I mean, I can remind you, Sundays, you know, Sunday afternoon in particular, being the most boring time.
And that was saying something.
Yeah.
Especially if you had no money, as we didn't.
Yeah.
I mean, so we played tennis. You know, that's what we did and what sport we had. And I read. Thank God for that local library, which fed my imagination.
Yes.
And I was a voracious reader of everything I could get my hands on, even a great deal of stuff I couldn't understand. And my favourite book that I got from that library was a photography book where there was a double page spread of Marilyn Monroe in a pinup in the 1950s, that famous one of her on the red velvet. I just couldn't believe that something like that existed in my local library. That was a relief from the boredom anyway.
No, I like it. I like it a lot. And you wrote a competition winning story about James Bond and a shark.
When I was 11, yeah. When I look at it back at it now, it wasn't my finest work.
No,
I think they seem to have forgotten to take his gun away. Also, it was underwater, so how the gun worked in the first place, I don't know. So it was quite implausible. But somehow, I do remember very clearly a moment when my essay was read out as being the sort of the outstanding one, and I felt very proud. And whether that had anything to do with my future trajectory, I don't know.
Yes. No, but I mean, you know, that's great. That's great. Brilliant. Obviously, Steven Spielberg was hanging around the school at the same time and
clearly
got the idea for Jaws and, you know, there you go, but no royalties. I mean, what can you say? I'd sue him.
That's the writer's life.
Yeah. okay, so I'm going to move forward a bit because I know there's an interesting thing which I think is, for some people, a common experience, and then for some, they'd never ever have this experience ever, and that is taking acid. And you and a friend took some acid, and it was not the best experience.
Well, I took it twice in my teens.
Right.
And the first time it was fantastic, and the second time it started off fantastic and then just kind of went wrong. I think, again, partly because of my ADHD brain. I can remember my mind racing so fast, and that it kind of catapulted out of control, and I was in a state of intense psychedelic chaos which was unbelievably, inexpressibly distressing, really.
Yes. I mean, this was, it came out of the book, you know, Scent of Dried Roses, that you talked about, you know, you were on this bad trip, as it were, and you went round to your friend's parents' house, I think, and which is kind of an odd thing to do, or maybe not, but I think there were some interesting consequences of that.
Well, I was abandoned, basically, and by my friend, he was freaked out by having me.
Right.
And, you know, then I ended up going home and just remember being very, very, very frightened.
Yeah.
And looking for my baby brother, who was, I think, a few years old at the time.
Right.
For some kind of security.
Yeah.
It was a horrible experience.
Yes. No, well, they can be, can't they?
Oh, I mean, it's more than horrible. I mean, it was a life-defining experience in many ways. I think it was absolutely central to creating my worldview. In a very serious way. I mean, I don't necessarily mean a bad way. I mean, once anyone who's taken LSD, if they choose to intellectualize it,
yeah,
will very quickly understand that what we perceive on a day-to-day basis is simply a projection of the brain, and the LSD makes that very, very clear indeed, that that what you're seeing is merely a almost a virtual reality projection.
Yeah.
And what lies underneath it is much more profound, much more mysterious, and much realer than the kind of very limited vision of reality that we carry around with us on a day-to-day basis. Even to this day, I'd be incredibly interested in microdosing, I'd be terrified of ever having the full experience again.
Yes.
and wouldn't want to. But it remains, without doubt, the most powerful experience of my life.
Right, but it didn't sort of make you, you know, run a mile and go, I am never, ever doing anything like that again.
Yeah, it did, but though I accidentally did it again by taking one too many magic mushrooms when I was much later.
Yeah.
And with much the same result, actually. I had another terrible bad trip when I was about 28.
Really?
Yeah, and it was like a rerun of the one when I was a teenager. It was awful, absolutely awful. So it's certainly a drug that you have to be profoundly careful with, especially if you have a mental issues in the first place. Not that I realised, of course, that I had any mental issues at the time.
Yeah, that was the whole thing with so many people in the music world. You know, Sid Barrett, you know, the Pink Floyd. I mean, he just took too much.
Green.
Yes. Yeah. Very well said. But I had a girlfriend. I mean, just as an aside, I had a girlfriend who took it a few times when she was 14, 15. And it just kept on coming back, you know, the bad trip. And she,
how awful.
And she just, she just stopped drinking, smoking, everything. She wouldn't touch anything and hasn't for 40, 50 years.
But it stopped in the end, did it?
Yes. Yeah. But she couldn't stand the feeling of being out of control. Just couldn't cope with it, you know. Anyway, there we go. Well, it's always good to talk about. I mean, we could talk about mescaline, peyote, and doors of perception, and Huxley.
Well, I think it's, you know, just as a final thought on that, I mean, I think it's very interesting that finally some of the taboos about it, which have got good reason to be there in some ways, are coming off. You know, people are beginning to indulge in medical experimentation, certainly for the treatment of depression, which I think is overdue, probably.
Yeah, well, I mean, and my final bit on this is what, of course, is interesting there is, you know, electric shock treatment has come back as an acceptable treatment now for severe depression.
I didn't think it ever went away.
It did. Well, it did in the sense that one flew over the cuckoo's nest, and various other videos going around, everyone went, my God, this is absolutely savage, we're never allowing it. But it's now proven to be, not for everybody, but has proved to be quite effective without terrifying consequences.
Yeah, as a matter of last resort, it does appear to
have an effect. Yeah, that's right. Anyway, okay, so we're going to move on. And you went through school, came out, and then when you were 19, you were asked to go work on a music paper? Was that right?
Yeah, national music paper, yeah.
How did that happen then?
Before I went to the London School of Economics, which wasn't until I was 27,
yeah.
I went to the far more glamorous Harlow Technical College.
Yes.
Where I studied journalism, tabloid journalism, I suppose you would say, because we certainly weren't full of people for the Financial Times, and went to work for a local paper. I occasionally would submit reviews to Sounds magazine.
Yes.
And then they asked me if I was interested in applying for a job, and I went to see them, and they gave me the job. And then at the age of 19, I was sort of jetting around the world interviewing pop stars, because in those days, the music papers were very, very powerful.
Yes, they were.
The national newspapers hadn't really cottoned on to pop music for some strange reason.
Yeah. Oh, great. And that's where you ended up doing a sort of exclusive David Bowie interview.
Yes, I did. I did actually come across him on a train. It wasn't a result of a great journalistic coup so much as the luck I had is that he was coming back from a performance on Mark Boland's TV show.
Yeah.
And I was there to cover a band called Eddie and the Hot Rods.
Yes.
And I was sort of with Eddie and the Hot Rods in second class on the train, and he invited us all up to his first class compartment to join him for some lunch.
Excellent.
It was very nice. I think he just thought I was a member of Eddie and the Hot Rods.
Right.
And I wasn't about to disabuse him.
Yes.
So I made notes on a paper plate underneath the table, and therefore got my first exclusive with David Bowie, though not an entirely above the board fashion. But then I was taught at journalism school that the story was the only thing that counted. I don't really take the same view now, but then I can afford to not take the same view.
Oh, good. Well, you'll be delighted to know that there is a coincidence here, that the first person who ever did a shed talk is a chap called Tim Clark, who was the managing director of Island Records with Eddie and the Hot Rods. As a guess. So we'll have to, you know, when we have the 20th reunion party, I'll introduce you, and then you can, you know, he's a great guy, actually. He manages Robbie Williams now, slightly different.
Oh, more profitable, I would imagine.
Slightly, yes, slightly. Anyway, so let's get to the meat and potatoes. Really, this next, you know, your early 20s were really successful.
I mean, then I left and set up my own magazine when I was 23, I think, and founded my own magazine with my partner, Barry Kane.
This is Flexipop.
Yeah. And, you know, we made money out of that. This was the 80s, you know, everyone was on the make, certainly people like me. I was kind of tootling around a little red Jeep, and I was just, you know, standard yuppie, really. I was having what looked on the surface to be a great time, although I was, you know, even then quite depressed a lot of the time.
And right.
I didn't know I was depressed. I didn't know what it was. And I think I was ADHD too, obviously.
Yes.
I didn't know what that was either. I just thought, I don't feel very good a lot of the time.
Yeah.
I never felt at ease or, you know, I didn't have any peace of mind. I was always on edge, you might say.
Yeah.
Looking at the world out the corner of my eye. I just felt that I can't believe that this is the right way I should be feeling.
Yeah.
And one of the things I think it was constantly driving me forward to find that place where I could be at ease.
Yes. Yeah. Were you doing many drugs and drinking at that stage?
Probably. Yeah. Yeah. Well, I was drinking and smoking enormous amounts, but then so was everybody.
Yeah.
Again, highly overrated activities, both of them.
Yeah, yeah.
And yes, taking drugs of whatever was around at the time. I think it was speed mostly in those days. But I don't blame any of that for my mental health. I think that was just part of the culture of the day.
Yeah. Anyway, it doesn't matter. I mean, basically, you were rolling in some ways it was really successful. You started at the LSE, you decided to put yourself through that, which is pretty amazing. What was that like? Were you all plain sailing there, or?
No, it was terrible. I mean, me going to the LSE, which I did again because I just wasn't satisfied with being a small businessman. I thought making money was kind of boring.
Yeah.
So I went to the LSE. I don't know why I went to the LSE. I had no idea even what I didn't have any friends who went to university. My parents didn't know anyone went to university. I remember asking, just because he went to the LSE as well, Robert Elms.
Oh, right.
I kind of vaguely knew him from the music business. Yeah. I said, you know, what university should you go to? He said, oh, go to the LSE. It's great. I went, oh, okay. And that was it. I just went to the LSE and I applied for an interview and they gave me a place.
Right.
But I was entirely out of my depth intellectually and class-wise as well. So, I mean, there were no working-class kids at the LSE and I didn't know what I was doing.
Right.
And then I broke up with my girlfriend who I was, like, madly in love with. So I was in a very bad place. I was lonely. I was pushed to the edge intellectually, I think. Sitting in library all day didn't help.
Yeah.
I was, like, 10 years older than everybody else at the university. It was really hard. And then I remember, like, I got the degree, 2-1 or whatever, and there was nothing, you know. There was no, like, it's not like when you're, nowadays, you're kind of a big celebration when you left university.
Yeah.
It was like, oh, I got a degree. My parents didn't care, you know, because, like, didn't mean anything to them. It was just like, one day I found out I got a degree and that was it. There was no celebration of any kind. You know, it was, I had no sense of achievement.
Yeah.
I mean, although I think now it was a great, an amazing achievement, but I didn't really feel that at the time. I mean, you know, I was depressed. So nothing really was very positive. And I was always looking to find something positive because my essential worldview was negative. You know, it's a horrible place to be. Not that I didn't have a lot of fun. Mm. I did. But the fun was always a way of escaping the kind of inner unease that I always felt at the time.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I get it. I mean, I suppose, without being wanting to be didactic with this, with the old shed talks, the point is to really offer people an insight, a real, genuine insight into what things can be like. And I think that some people think depressions are always completely reactive and, you know, it's 60 to naught in a week. They don't realise that, you know, it's a gradual process sometimes.
Well, it's a state of being.
Mm. Yeah.
It was for me. It was a state of being at that time I didn't know I was in.
Yeah.
It wasn't until, you know, which we'll come to, I recovered from having a breakdown that I understood what it was just to feel normal.
Yeah. So what happened? I mean, did you get the girl back? Or what happened? Did you find a new one?
Did I get the girl back? Well, no, I found a new one and she was great, but I was too fucked up really to have any kind of relationship with her either, and so I hurt her very badly, which I regret greatly, but I really didn't know what I was doing, stumbling from one moment to the other.
Yeah,
I was just
a
and I was just very, very lonely.
Yes.
And very solitary, very puzzled, a big mountain of thoughts piling up on top of each other. You know, which obviously wasn't helped by being at university because that was all you did was sit all day around and think. Or at least that's what I did. I'm not sure that many other people there did that, but I was there to try and work things out. And, you know, coming from the background I came from, I mean, I don't know what I was thinking of. In a way, I was determined to solve the mysteries of the universe.
Yeah.
And amazingly, I didn't really manage it. but I sort of thought I'd die trying.
Yeah.
And I nearly did, you know. I mean, I just at one point, my whole mental edifice just collapsed. And that was, I just couldn't do it anymore. Because after that, I come to this, after the university, I then was unemployed for 6 months.
Yes. So no job, no girlfriend.
No job, no girlfriend. Obsessively writing a diary.
Yeah. Where were you living? Were you living in a flat
in Notting Hill, yeah.
Okay.
Then I was given a job way beyond my abilities. as the editor of City Limits magazine.
Which was the opposite of the competitor Time Out, yeah.
Well, it was, yeah, and it was also very, very woke in those days.
Yeah.
It was like, every, you know, the cleaner had a vote on what we should put in the newspaper.
Yeah.
Didn't really sit easily with me, having come from my publishing background.
Yes.
So yeah. I resigned after 2-3 weeks, and then I had a breakdown, yeah.
Yeah, and presumably you just thought, no, you can't even do City Limits.
Well, I felt I'd let a lot of people down.
Yeah.
You know, and I mean, I had a staff of 80 or something, and, you know, and it did fold sort of maybe 6 months to a year later. So, you know, I did feel they were desperate for someone to save it, and I was meant to be their saviour. But, you know, I really couldn't manage it. I couldn't. I've learned now, you know, I am somebody who has. I have extraordinarily good ideas, but I can't organise them.
Yes.
And if it requires administration,
yeah,
and people management, I'm just no good at it. But yeah. I do have great ideas, and that's why people employ me. And that's what happened to me later in when I was in television as well. You know, basically people take me on because I have great ideas, and they sack me because I realise that I can't follow them.
You can't follow them. Yeah, no, I get that. But let me ask you a question. You know, when you left City Limits and it was pretty terrible, I mean, what was your default sort of inner moan? I mean, were you somebody who harangued yourself going, you know, bloody idiot, you didn't do that. You're always cocking these things up. Oh, well, you're not like that. And there was some other issue.
It was quite mysterious, really. I mean, all I knew is that I had to die. You know, that was all I knew. And that my deepest self was, it was like Freud's death wish had taken me over.
Right.
And I didn't know how it was going to happen. All I knew is that it had to happen and I had to do it.
Right.
But I didn't understand, you know, I mean, I was effectively mad. You know, I think I'd gone mad. And I really, and not that you'd have known.
Yeah.
You know, I wasn't a gibbering wreck. I was entirely rational.
Right.
But inside myself, I completely lost the plot. And, you know, I think the formula is one well known to people who suffer depression, which is, you know, people who feel this bad must have done something wrong.
Of course.
And that's, you know, that's a classic formulation for anybody with a depressive mindset. And I believed I'd become, you know, possessed by the devil because I felt so awful and I couldn't work out, you know, why I felt so awful.
Yeah.
And the only formulation I could come up with is that I must be a terrible person.
And the only way of dealing with that was to have an honourable or noble death, or almost like a Japanese samurai.
Yeah, I think it did feel noble in a strange way. Yeah, though, again, I don't know how much it was a thought. It was a weird kind of compulsion,
yeah,
from deep within me that this was something that, you know, it was very peculiar because I really didn't want to kill myself, but I kind of had to.
Yeah, no,
it was like,
no,
it was very strange. Yeah,
yes.
Yeah. I wasn't even miserable. I was just like, I was just demented.
Yeah, that's very interesting. And I mean, and it presumably, I mean, I know from the book, you describe it as getting, you know, worse and worse and worse over a period of months, you know,
yeah,
where you no longer cared what you looked like and no longer cared,
yeah,
about clothes or washing or all that stuff. And
yeah, I went back to live with my parents. I was, you know. And I remember very clearly talking of loving parents. This is the thing that does show how loving they could be. I mean, they were they had lived in a very modest suburban working class terrace in,
yeah,
Southall. And they were, you know, I remember them talking about selling the house so they could send me to a private mental hospital, which would have left them homeless. But I think they were seriously considering it, which didn't make me feel better, obviously. And so I returned to my infantile state by returning to my parents and also like going to the library again and sitting and reading books.
Because it's safe.
I suppose. I didn't know what else to do again. But I was utterly, utterly lost. Yeah.
No, I think people do go into that thing of just safe mode. And, you know, as you say, childlike, really,
yeah,
where there's nothing terrible, you know, happening, or you hope nothing terrible's happening.
You know, I was also very aware that I was a great burden on my parents, which I didn't, particularly my mother, which I didn't really want to be.
Yes, yeah. Well, maybe we can talk about that. I mean, because that, in the end, I think I'm right, that began to affect her.
Well, there were a lot of things that were affecting her at the time. Right. I mean, you know, I tried to try and steer away, myself away from the idea that I, how responsible I am for what happened to her.
Yeah.
I mean, we know if, you know, she killed herself in the end. But, you know, there are many factors in that. I mean, one of the facts, she was depressive. Not that I ever knew that. She was prescribed Lagactyl, you know, as a, when she was pregnant with either me or my brother, I can't remember which. So there was that, and there was the fact that, you know, her third child, my brother James, had left home, and Southall had changed beyond recognition.
Yes,
it become an Asian town.
It had by that stage, had it.
Yeah, by the 1980s, the South where she grew up in had completely disappeared.
Yeah.
I think she was the only white woman left in her street.
Right.
And she felt very lonely.
Right.
Very alienated, very separated. And my father had been made redundant from work. So there are all kinds of reasons why she might not feel great.
Yeah. No, I'm not trying to put the thing at your door. I'm just saying that was what I thought appeared from the book, that she found it very difficult to cope with, probably because it just radiated her own depression.
Yeah, any mother would find it difficult.
Yeah, sure. But I mean, why? Just speaking of that, why do you think she made that choice or the decision?
I don't know to what extent it is a decision, you know. I mean, I think it's when the illness is that severe, you know, to what extent any element of free will enters into it is questionable. So I can't possibly speculate on her motives. She certainly would have never said anything about them. I don't think she had motives in the sense, again, I think she went crazy. I don't think she had any... You know, she had. We all have reasons to suffer and to be unhappy, but I don't think she had any reason to kill herself.
Yeah.
I think she was just very, very seriously depressed.
Right.
She had started taking antidepressants, but she killed herself, I think, after 10 days or so afterwards. So they would not have had an effect. And they may have made her worse.
They could have done.
So it's quite possible that, you know, antidepressants, which I had urged her to take, may have been one of the triggers. Then again, who knows?
Yeah. Well, it can happen that you have great hopes and you think, oh, I'm taking these now. That's really great. And then suddenly you find that it's not great, because sometimes they don't. You get worse before you get better. But then people didn't always know about that.
No.
You know, so it must have been a terrible time for you and your dad and your family to come to terms with. I mean, did that just send you reeling, or did it actually do the opposite? Did you find you came back together?
Well, oddly enough, I was back together already. I mean, I was, you know, I'd recovered.
Right.
As a result of being prescribed antidepressants,
right,
which miraculously, which I'd resisted for years, miraculously solved the problem in a matter of weeks. And I just woke up one day and thought, oh, things are fine. And I then sort of realised how much this whole thing had been lodged in my, you know, brain chemistry.
Yeah.
Although I know that, you know, there's a big debate about how much it's a part of inner dialogue or brain chemistry.
Yeah.
I don't know the answer to that.
Yeah.
But you know, basically, I know it sounds terrible in a way, but losing my mother was much less painful than suffering depression.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, I mean, depression is worse than grief because it's just an endless, dead awfulness, you know, and grief is a process that you go through, whereas depression is more like being stuck in one place
yeah
forever a black place forever, you know, and grief is, grief feels like that sometimes, but it does change and develop. And that's the difference in a way between grief and depression. Depression is grief that doesn't end,
yeah,
and doesn't really have any reason.
But also I think you can do something about grief up to a point, you know, you can actually,
yeah,
you know, you can visit a graveside, you can look at photographs, you can talk to people. And sometimes when depression gets really bad, then that's just tough luck. I mean, that's how it is.
Yeah, there's nothing you, I mean, if you, well, I mean, I think medicine is very effective and therapy is effective. There are ways now of for most people that they can at least ameliorate it. But I mean, at the time, you know, you mentioned One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, which in many ways is an unbelievably damaging film.
Mm-hmm.
Although I loved it, but I mean, it was wrong.
I think we, yeah, that was the interesting thing about it, isn't it?
Yeah, it was massively misguided.
We all loved it, you know.
And it was all about the fantasy that, you know, it was all about, you know, your relationship with your mother or whatever. But I mean, and of course, that's an element of it. But the idea that that medicine was any good. And, you know, there are other things that conspired to me resisting taking antidepressants. My uncle, Alan,
yes,
who was kind of, what would we call him? Probably call him learning disabled nowadays. Or possibly,
yeah, great character there. Great character in the book. Wonderful. Yeah. Loved him.
Borderline.
Loved him.
Borderline autistic.
Yeah.
But he had a mental breakdown. And all I remember from that was he didn't get better till he stopped taking medication.
Yeah, sure.
But I think they were giving him things like Valium in those days. And that wasn't good. And I knew of other cases where people have been really badly affected by taking medication. But I think there was a moment of transition from, as it were, prescribing kind of opiate-like drugs to tricyclic drugs,
yes,
and antidepressants, which are very different beasts. And people had kind of got the two mixed up in their mind. So I came along at a bad time, really, and I can only be very grateful that my psychiatrist at the time kind of bullied me into taking these,
yeah,
drugs, because, I mean, I just really was very, very sceptical. And, you know, since then, well, I've been on them ever since. On and off, pretty, yeah, much on, more than off.
And you've, and really, the interesting thing that I read anyway, I hope you don't mind me saying this, that you've perhaps, it's almost like alcoholics, you know, you have two or three slips, you know, where you go out and have a drink. And I think in your particular case, you basically came off the meds two or three times, but each time, you know, coincided with something. Like, there was one point I think you talked about, or you're talking about, where you had a whole series of bereavements. Like your
right,
agent, who I knew, well, my wife knew him actually very well, Rod Hall, which must have been a pretty awful time.
Yeah, he was murdered, and another friend of mine, Kate Carr, a journalist, died, and there was, you know, it was, and then I fell into depression again. You know, I would say this, anyone who's listening to this who's thinking of trying to get off antidepressants, well, you know, I don't blame you. Not that they have had any side effects for me that I'm aware of, but be careful, because, you know, the more you cycle on and off, the harder it is to get them to work again.
Yes.
And sometimes it took me up to a year to get back on an even keel. And it could be, I mean, another time was a trigger, was a disgraceful, not unlike this situation, which isn't disgraceful, but could, you know, it was a radio interview for Radio 4 in which I was talking about my mother.
Yeah.
And the interviewer was absolutely brutal.
Right.
As it were, trying to pin my mother's death on me. It was very strange.
Right.
And
right,
I came out shaking, and I fell into a depression for like a year after that because, gosh, of that one interview. Because I was not on my meds. I've learned since now that, you know, I'm just not going to make that mistake again.
Don't mess around with it. Yeah, no, I understand that. I think, and that's good to hear. I mean, I think the point is that everyone is different, and, you know, medications are different, have different effects on different people. Yeah.
You've got to try them, I think, if you're suffering depression. And if they don't work, then get off them. But, I mean, if they do work, then I wouldn't hold back, personally.
Yeah. So can I just ask you, and this is, again, for the benefit of our listeners, you were diagnosed with ADHD, which seems to be almost quite a trendy thing at the moment. I mean, and I don't mean that rudely to you. I just mean it seems to be the diagnosis happening a lot. But what, you know, can you just say what happened to you and why it has made a difference, you know?
Yeah, I mean, ADHD and depression are comorbid.
Yeah.
In other words, if you have one, you tend to have the other. Or if you have ADHD, you certainly can expect to have depression.
Right.
But I only found out about ADHD, which, as you say, has become the mental illness du jour.
That's very funny. Sorry.
Everyone's bloody got it at the moment. But I was first there, I think, as I was with depression. I was ahead of the curve.
Yeah.
I just remember I was writing a weekly column on The Guardian at the time.
Yeah.
And I wrote a piece about how, what a fuckwit I was, basically, and how I just forgot things and was clumsy and would forget very important appointments. And, you know, it was infuriating for my wife and blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
And what an idiot I was. And this person just wrote to me and said, "It doesn't sound to me like you've got a bad memory. It sounds to me like you've got ADHD. And I had no idea what she was talking about. But I was intrigued enough to start Googling ADHD. And when I sort of came to a checklist of ADHD symptoms, every single one did I tick. And sure enough, I took the trouble to go to the ADHD Centre in Liverpool, which is where the centre of studies are, to find out about, you know, whether I might have it. And sure enough, you know, I was diagnosed quite quickly as having moderate ADHD, is what they said.
Attention deficit hyperactivity disorder.
Yeah, I mean, they separate them more nowadays into ADD and ADHD.
Yes.
Nowadays, I think I'm much more ADD than ADHD. But I certainly, when I was younger, I was very hyperactive. I couldn't sit still. I found it very difficult to just even sit and watch television. It was like very hard for me.
No, I get it. But Tim, how come you were able to write all those books? How did you do it?
Well, I mean, there's a little known element of ADHD is something called hyperfocus.
Oh.
And if you the thing about people with ADHD minds is they're not interested in very much.
Right.
But when they are interested in something, they become kind of obsessed by
yes.
it. And if I can get onto that, if I can get onto that bandwagon where I'm really interested in something, and it can take a long time, even when I'm starting to write a novel, it becomes my life almost. I become very compulsive about it. I become absolutely caught up in certain things and ideas and people. You know, I'm horribly given to falling in love with people inappropriately. and then sort of, you know, living to regret it. But I become obsessive.
But is that falling in love, or is it like having a major crush or fixation?
I don't know. I don't even know it's anything to do with ADHD. I mean, my wife always used to say to me, you know, we used to play this game and she would call it ADHD or twat. And she wasn't sure, are you being an ADHD or are you being a twat? And it's quite hard to separate the two, because they do look, you know, when I was depressed, people used to call me a miserable git.
Yeah.
And when I had ADHD, it was like people just thought I was rude and opinion. And people don't really understand ADHD, because it's a bit like depression was 30 years ago.
Yeah.
You know, people don't get it. They're very suspicious of it. Because they think it's a way of, like, you know, excusing yourself for all kinds of things. And that's a comment I often get. It's always very convenient, you know, that you can't control your emotional responses sometimes, so you seem to be very rude.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's very interesting that you just, you know, don't take any notice of anybody else. And it's very difficult that you seem very egotistical, and it's very handy that you forget things and you can forgive yourself.
But is it not... you know, where everything... I read a book once, a Canadian book, about 20 years ago, called Scattered Minds, and it was about this subject. And I don't know whether that makes sense to you, that, you know, everything's quite scattered and...
Yeah, that's a very good way of putting it. I mean, scattered mind is about right. You're scatty.
Yeah.
You know, the word scatty is from scattered, I suppose.
Yeah.
And I've been called scatty as long as I can remember. And yet, you know, I can be incredibly focused and incredibly efficient and sort of tough-minded.
Yeah.
And then, you know, then I can forget where the loo is.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's a peculiar way, but it's enormously helpful for me and for my daughter, actually, to have received a diagnosis. Takes a huge burden off your back.
No, that's good. Okay, so that in a way was really good. So we sort of morph in now to what we call the life jackets. Now, I don't know whether you totally got the concept of life jackets or not. But
probably not. No.
Probably not, no. Okay, well, I'm going to tell you again. So life jackets is what you want around you to make you feel okay, basically, you know, to keep you on the level. So it could be, you know, your favorite piece of music, you know, like you, I mean, like the film you've chosen, Syndosh, is that right? Am I pronouncing it right?
I think it's called Synecdoche.
Oh, of course it is, yeah. Well, I was just testing you to make sure. Yeah.
Synecdoche, NY,
yeah.
In New York, yeah.
And Philip Seymour Hoffman, wow, yeah. Charlie Kaufman directed
it. He's my
it.
Hero as yeah. a writer and wrote it. I think he's amazing, Charlie Kaufman. I think he's just
yeah.
incredible.
Yeah, no, I agree. He is. I mean, I hadn't seen this film, but I peered into it for a bit, and I could see why you liked it, I think.
And why was that?
Well, because I think you identify with the Philip Seymour Hoffman character.
Yeah, probably. Yeah, I do. Yeah.
And he had his wife and... young daughter. I don't know if that's any coincidence.
Well, yeah, and he was a narcissistic, mad, creative madman. So that has something to do with it.
But, I mean, look, is there not another film that you might take, you know, that's slightly more cheery or something or other, you know?
Well, if I want to feel happy.
Well, it's going to stop you going down to the basement, you know.
Well, I think a musical, you know. I mean, South Pacific was one option. I love South Pacific.
Yeah.
I love Cabaret. That's quite a dark musical.
Love Cabaret.
Yeah. I mean, I love musicals. I love the old Hollywood musicals. I love 42nd Street.
Yeah.
You can't go wrong with a good musical, I don't think. And though I do tend towards the darker stuff.
Yeah. No.
Which is the Candor and Ebb, Candor and Ebb stuff, something like not only Cabaret, but Chicago was also wonderful. But, yeah, I mean, I also love Mary Poppins. I also love Sound of Music. My God.
There's
yeah,
a soft side
those.
Of Tim Lott.
I'm all soft. I mean, I'm just a big... I'm a big bunch of soft
softness.
Tissue.
Yeah.
Soft tissue.
Soppiness.
Yeah.
My
whole life has been trying to protect that softness.
Yes. Okay. All right. Well, I noticed the TV series you've chosen is called Maniac.
I don't know what was going on in my unconscious when I was answering this. It's actually very funny. It's actually very funny.
Is it?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's very, very funny. It's very funny indeed.
Okay.
And although it sounds dark, it is in fact incredibly crazy. It's very Charlie Kaufman-esque, though.
Yeah.
Very, very sort of surreal and very witty and dark, but also, you know, it really makes you laugh. And
okay.
I'm all in favour of laughter.
Yes.
You know?
No, I mean, no. Well, this is good. We applaud that. During the lockdown, did you watch Call My Agent?
Yeah, I love Call My Agent, yeah. I mean, it's great, yeah.
I thought that was the best. I thought it was just so funny. Well written, very well written, I thought. Okay, well, I'm going to have to say, now, we haven't got a book choice here out of you. And
haven't you?
No.
I would certainly put... Crossroads by Jonathan Franzen down. All the Jonathan Franzen novels.
Right.
I think are just fantastic and funny and brilliant and insightful. I mean, he's the modern Dickens as far as I'm concerned. I think he's amazing. So I would definitely put Jonathan Franzen down there to cheer me up.
Okay. Did you ever like Graham Swift? I mean, you don't worry if you didn't.
Yeah, very much. I mean, I very much liked Waterland. You know, I was very big a fan of those sort of macho male writers like Stephen Burkoff and Harold Pinter and Philip Roth and John Updike. I mean, I grew up with all those writers. And
actually, that just because I never remember what to say in these things, I have got thought for you. I just want to ask you a question. Have you ever written a play?
No. I'd love to, but I never have, no.
Okay, I think you'd write a great play. I'm reading your latest, well, one of your latest books, When We Were Rich. And, you know, you have a postgraduate degree in being excruciating. Or, you know.
Yes, that's my speciality.
It's excruciatingly funny or excruciatingly sad, which is fine. It just struck me it's such an obvious thing for you. Just because you were so, you know, good at observing those scenes and situations. And I'm just reading the early part of that book, and this couple have gone down to the girlfriend, the wife's parents in Chalfont St. Peter, and it's, you know, they're taking their mum. Oh my God, I love it. I love it.
Thank you.
I listened to Gillian Welch.
Gillian. Look,
you say Gillian, I say Gillian.
Okay.
Is it? Right. Well, like, it's one of those, isn't it? What, Welch?
It's Gillian.
Oh, all right. It's Gillian Welch. I don't like her anyway. No, I'm joking. I thought it was very good.
She's great.
I'm living in, you know, darker Somerset. We don't have much radio and you know, things like that.
So the wireless.
Our wireless comes on at 3 o'clock on a Sunday. But no, I really liked it. I thought it was very smart. Yeah. But you're an exercise person, cycling, tennis, walking. That's good.
Yes. I play a lot of tennis, yeah.
Oh, do you? Right. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Got it. I like that a lot. All right. Well, I mean, there's probably many more things to talk about. And, you know, Substack, you're mentoring boot camp. Is this some sort of subliminal torture thing that you're doing to writers?
Yeah. I like to make people suffer.
Yes.
Particularly writers. I am suspicious of writers who tell me how much they enjoy writing. Because I just think, really?
Really?
You know, I mean,
stop lying.
If you enjoy writing too much, you're probably not a real writer.
Yeah, right, I agree with that.
It's like saying, oh, I really enjoy, you know, if I'm an athlete, getting up at 5 a.m. and doing road work.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, yeah, do you? I mean, you know, it's just something you have to do in order to become a good athlete.
Yeah.
And in order to become a good writer, in my book, you know, it ain't all fun.
No.
And a lot of it is slog and frustrating and difficult and above all, complex. I mean, I don't think there's anything, you know, I can think of more complex than putting together a novel properly.
Right.
People seem to have a image of that it's simple and therefore they'll have a go. And I'm here to disabuse them of that fact.
Yeah.
So I'm the kind of the opposite of all the sort of you can do it. I'm sort of said you probably can't do it, but it's worth trying because writing is incredibly important.
Yeah.
And novels are very important. But if you want to be a good writer, you have to work at it.
Absolutely.
It's not just going to be something you do with your pals on your creative writing community and all pat each other on the back. You've got to really knuckle down.
Put the work in,
absolutely. So yeah, that's me, and my Substack thread is a way initially of getting lots of people, you know, to share the knowledge that I've learned in 20 years of writing and teaching, also in the longer term, to make me some kind of income. But that's still very much a minor factor at the moment because I'm not making very much income. But one day I might. Who knows?
Yes, I would think so. So the last thing I'm going to say to you now, and I'm going to give you 30 seconds to think about this whilst I'm saying it. You think about it. So if somebody, if you came across somebody, you know, who was, I don't know, 20, 25, and really, you know, depressed, but, you know, in some vague functioning sort, to remind you of you, basically, you know, what sort of, what would you say? Have you got anything? Oh, no, it's not a trick question. It's just sort of, you know, like you might say, go and live in the country, go and learn how to swim. What's your vibe? You know, what's your good advice?
Well, I mean, it's a very good question, and it's one that, you know, I wish that someone was be able to come to me when I was depressed and answer that question for me. The answer is, above all, because this is the worst thing about depression, is you have no sense of the future that things will get better, is that this goes away. You know, it will not, because when you're in it, it feels perpetual.
Yeah.
And eternal.
It feels like forever.
This goes away. And even now, when I occasionally get a bit depressed, it's like, oh God, this will always be, you know, it goes away. It's not you. It's some kind of interloper that gets hold of you sometimes. Mm. And I'd also say, for God's sake, therapy is very useful. And if you can find a good therapist, which is easier said than done, quite frankly.
Yes.
But if you can find a good therapist, I think it's very, very useful. But for God's sake, don't turn away from medication because you went to see One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest or something similar, because there's something very much in the sort of still, and much less so than used to be, in the sort of Guardian reading intellectual circles in which I suppose I am marooned, you know, that taking medication is some kind of a failure or an admission of you know, a loss of sovereignty as a human being. And I would really urge you, you know, to give it a try, because what's the worst that can happen? If it doesn't work, stop taking it.
Yeah.
If it does work, then you're better, you know, and my God, you know, that, believe me, that's the greatest thing, because I think, you know, to me, I'm eternally grateful for Dr. Prozac or whoever he is, you know, that came up with these medications, because I would be dead now without them.
Yeah.
I have no doubt about that. And I'd have been dead by my own hand or I'd be living on the streets, I don't know. But I'd be very miserable.
Yeah. Tim, thank you. You've been a top rocker.
Great pleasure.
Thank you so much. Really great. We will be in touch. We are Substacked up to our eyeballs. And look forward to speaking to you very soon. Again, but thank you very, very much for joining us today. All right.
Thank you for the opportunity. All right.
Okay.
Bye-bye now.
Take care. Bye. And now it's suddenly the moment you've been waiting for. It's Karen Cowan.
Hi.
Great. Haven't seen you for ages, and this is great that you're back in the chair. And really good, really good.
Well, it's great to see you, Jeremy, as well.
Excellent. We like that. So here we are, episode 11, and this has been an extraordinary episode. Tim Lott. Wow, quite an episode. So how did you find it?
I found it utterly fascinating, and I felt that Tim seems to have ended up a really grounded, intelligent, together man who's got a really good understanding of himself, and that he covered just so many subjects to do with mental well-being and mental health in a very short time, all of which he had a fascinating and very considered take on. And I would say, just at the beginning, he said, when you asked him what his interests were, one of the things he said was complaining. And I think a big thing that came across was that he doesn't seem to complain, despite all the traumas, including being operated on without anaesthetic when he was a baby. you know, and he doesn't seem to complain about it. He seems to just continue to work on himself and live as best a life as he can. That's how it comes across.
Yes. Well, I thought Tim is somebody who doesn't complain about his lot. Uh-huh. But I do think he's probably got a private PhD in grumpiness when he wants to have one. But I mean, you know, there are some pretty shocking things in that, and that business of being, you know, born with a hair lip and having cancer of the kidney. I mean, crikey, you know, that's a pretty grim start for him, and the effect that it had on his mother, who was also in hospital for 3 months. The fact that his brother had to move out of home. Extraordinary. And, of course, I should say that it is difficult with once you've read The Scent of Dried Roses, the memoir, it is very difficult to separate the two because it's so, it's such a wonderful memoir.
Such a wonderful, well-researched memoir. Yes, it is difficult to separate, but then... On the other hand, in the interview with Tim, I felt a lot came up that sort of wasn't in the book, and there's been a number of years since he wrote it, so he will have kind of moved on and had a lot more experience. His daughters will have grown up a lot, all sorts of things, won't he?
His story is extraordinary, with his, you know, particularly with his parents coming from a working class background in Southall. And his mum with alopecia. I thought it was really interesting. Not necessarily bang on the nose, but really interesting.
I thought it was really interesting. And I do think that clearly when people come from relatively sort of poor backgrounds, they often do want to kind of better themselves. And it's quite a balancing act to remain authentic, if I can use that rather overused word, and integrated, sort of moving up the ladder and sort of improving yourself whilst hanging on to your roots, because it can often be very damaging if you kind of throw it. This is a long conversation, but if you kind of badmouth to yourself your roots, because that is the very core of you.
This is a very interesting subject, isn't it? It's Pygmalion, and you know, it's the subject of a lot of books and musicals and all sorts of things. Just to move about a bit, you know, I personally thought his description of his depressions and, you know, consequently our discussions about medication. I mean, this is pretty... We haven't had that in-depth conversations on Shed Talks about medication before. Did you feel he gave an insight into the depression, severe depression?
Very, very much so. And I thought some of the things he said were extremely interesting. For example, the fact that you can have depression for a very, very long time and it creeps up on you before it gets so bad that you actually are forced to seek help or take action. All that time, you're probably believing what you're thinking, all the dark thoughts you're thinking, all the self-critical thoughts you're thinking. I thought that was interesting about the length of time depression can sort of roll on until it gets bad. I also thought it was really interesting and rational about antidepressants, because my own opinion is that you can be... A lot of people are anti-antidepressants, but my own experience from working in the NHS is that you can get to a stage where no amount of CBT or therapy is going to help you out of it. You need the sort of kick of the antidepressants to start you off, because you can get so low you can't even think about challenging thoughts or looking at the past and so on. So I thought that was very realistic.
Yes, I agree. No, I thought it was very honest throughout, actually. And we loved hearing about the acid trips.
Yes.
That was unusual.
That was very, very interesting. And I thought it was interesting that Tim said he thought it was probably one of the biggest experiences of his life. And in a way, I think, I'm not sure if he said this in the interview or whether I've read it somewhere else, but about how it made him see that the way you think is everything.
Yes.
And that the LSD trip made that even clearer kind of thing, and then the mushroom trip later on sort of thing. Yeah.
Well, that's, I think, again, it was an unusual sort of side turning to go on, you know, really. And, you know, he was in, you know, with his life jackets, you know, I'm not sure that he quite grasped what we were doing with those when he submitted them, but they did largely seem to be a little bit gloomy. And that was why I tried to get him, you know, onto some other subjects. And I said to him, come on, you must have something a bit more cheerful going on. And suddenly he starts talking about musicals, which is really funny.
Yes.
And brilliant. You know, and, you know, he liked cabaret. Well, that, yes, that makes sense. But then he went into, you know, I think it was almost, you know, paint your wagon and you get your gun. And
yes. All those really, really cheery things.
Yeah.
Yes.
I thought that was really great to hear, actually. Great to hear. And great to know that there's someone like Tim, he's quite tough about these things and going, I don't like that, I do like this. And I, actually, what I thought was he's going, no, I love musicals, I like going to them.
Yes.
Well, it was quite good. And you know, I'm sure that his boot camp, the writing thing, I mean, God, anybody wanting to write a really good memoir, my goodness. But, I mean, he, you know, he's written lots of other books, you know, Rumours of a Hurricane, White City Blue. I mean, these are good novels, very good. So, yeah, there you go. We'll put the plug in.
Yeah, I think he's an absolute wonderful, wonderful writer. And I'd read The Scent of Dried Roses. And when you talked about Tim coming on the show, I remembered the book very well. And the funny thing was, I loved rereading it. And I think I'd like to reread it again. It's just so good and so well researched and so authentic.
Yeah, well, it's that book is brilliant for many other reasons, and it's not just that it talks, you know, discusses, you know, his family and mental health. It's social history. It's all sorts of things in there. You know, relations with brothers, relations with mates. You know, what it was like to be bullied, and then how you know, right, I'm not going to be bullied anymore. I'm going to put this suit of armour on, and I'm becoming an arrogant git, and then people are frightened of me. It was great. It's wonderful.
Yes, I absolutely loved it, yeah.
Good. Well, we're giving Tim Lott a huge award for coming on Shed Talks. Any last words, Karen, that you want to say?
Yes, just to say again that I really, really enjoyed listening to Tim talking. I'm going to read his other books, and he seems to have really kind of worked hard on himself. And I suppose what I'd say is the next thing to work on or continue working on is guilt, because if anything came through the supreme groundedness and intelligence, it felt that there was a bit of kind of guilt around letting people down, such as at the magazine and his girlfriend and that sort of thing. And I wondered if those things still play on him or not.
Yes. Well, you need to perhaps go through a process to sort things out like that. Great. All right. Well, it has been really great to talk to you. And we've got various people coming in the next couple of months are going to be quite varied and different, and it's all going to be fantastic. I'm not going to tell you anything about them yet, but you're going to love it. Okay, thanks a lot, everyone, and tip top and tidy, and see you very, very soon. See you in the next one. All right.
Okay, bye.
Bye. Take care. Thank you to Stuart Bagshaw, our top engineer editor. Thank you to B. Brooke, our top administrator, production manager. Thank you to Karen Cowan, our top psychologist. If you want to find out more about Shed Talks, visit our website, jeremythomastalks.co.uk. Please sign up to the newsletter. If you want to write to us or find out anything about anybody or contact anyone on the show, inquiries at jeremythomastalks.co.uk. You can find us on Facebook at Shed Talks, Shed Talks, Twitter at JT Shed Talks, Instagram dash Jeremy Thomas Talks. So it's all been tip top and totally tidy. Stay safe, be groovy. Please sign up, support, and share this. Thanks a lot. Goodbye.